Howdy folks, Kathy Williams de Vries here, bringing you insights into Le Tombeau de Ravel by Arthur Benjamin. I've got a student who's learning this piece. I did learn this piece about 15 years ago, so I haven't touched it since then. It's a really, really tough blow. It's about 15 minutes, and you don't get a lot of rests, never any more than about 3 or 4 bars. And it has many different sections with different challenges. So the first page, I think your main challenge is the never-ending minor thirds. Although, in order to help you learn something like this, I would go into Closé and Behrmann and practice your minor thirds like that. And what is common, I think, to clarinet French music, French clarinet music, is the sort of chromatic sequence, which is what we're doing here. Effectively, what we have is a scale. And if you put the notes in there, and also I would encourage you to look at French etudes, which I think would help Jean-Jean. There's a really good one on Scaramouche in the Polichek studies that I think would help with these sorts of chromatic sequences. The Francais Concerto, of course, has many examples of these chromatic sequences. And what I do is I look through the piece and try and find where a particular diminished motif starts again, and that would be the allegro molto con sopra at the end of the piece. So what I would do would be to take first page and last page out and just have a look at these diminished thirds, the diminished chords. What I would do would be to pop the metronome probably on about 60. That's a nice sort of little speed. Maybe even a little bit slower. And I would try and get this as smooth as possible. And actually, I would take it even slower to probably about 50. Because there's no point rushing when you're in the practice room. So, and make sure you're not late off the quaver either. Oops, let's try that again. And I would try and probably do those in almost one breath. I'm going to address that in a moment, but let's stay on the theme of the diminished chords. And you need a good legato, otherwise it's a bit choppy. And you need to be going somewhere what these diminished, so minor thirds, are going towards are the second part of the phrase. So you're building towards that F and then coming away. So, very strong drive to the end of each of the phrases. And so now let's look down at the return of this at tempo 1, which is an extended chromatic sequence. Now that's a tough one. Maybe you can chop it up. And also you're getting softer, so you're coming off the forte and gradually coming down to a double P. Overblown B flat that I tend to use, or you could go. No, you can't really go to that one. Or I don't tend to trust it, especially up that high, especially that soft. Extended one as well along the same line. So that it's pretty much almost the same as the as just the bar before 3. Practice it. Just take out those little bits first, because you want your mind sort of working on one thing at a time, and if it comes back in a piece, then that's when you want to work on it. So we're just going to take out this little next bit and go to tempo 1. You'll find out fairly shortly. So tempo 1. You notice that I use the long B flat, A sharp there. So that's the first page. Now we know this comes back at the end of the piece. At the sort of the last double bar line, and much the same go. Oops. Here, let me just have a look. Yeah, we're on. So take a look at the key signature. We're no longer in two flats, which sort of tripped me up, but So that's where we put those two together. Always driving, driving, driving. And then right at the end. So what we do is we gradually move the metronome up. I'm going to chuck it up to 60. Hang on, let's try that again. And then down at tempo 1. So that's the first page. Now we're going to jump down to the end of the piece. So hang on, let's switch with now one sharp, not two flat. Quite an interesting little end. The piece. Okay, so what we're now going to look at, given that we've gotten a handle on those chromatic minor thirds, there's the next bit. You need to have a really, really great support and a really, really light staccato. Because I think a lot of clarinet players tongue too hard, so yeah, they really slap the tongue on the reed, and all you need is just the finest caress. And I think a lot of people have reeds that are too hard as well. I mean, the ideal reed is really, really free blowing. Now, how I practice this is maybe take the top E. And then maybe. And then eventually. Okay, so, and what I do is I get my metronome on and actually practice. So that once you've, and then. And it's a really good exercise because you get this. Sometimes my tonguing's so soft you actually can't hear me tonguing at all, which is not a good idea, but. So very. Slow lower tempo, especially when you're coming into this. You want that really smooth coming out of this. Really smooth. So if we add the rest of it, we'll take that mano allegro in a minute, but we come back to the colto mon brio on the last page and virtually the same thing. So let's work out this bit, shall we? So that you can see that very, very light tongue. So that sort of bar F sharp you like. So can use that long B flat. I'm sorry, I was taking my time. Actually, I'd probably overblow the B flat there. And then we come back. Very soft. A rip there. So again, and then we'll put that together. What am I doing? Speed there. Now, let's take this mano allegro on the first page and match that up with the finale on the final two pages. I know this seems a weird way to learn a piece, but it's something that I do. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pair up the mano allegro with the finale. Now I'm going to change into crotchets rather than the dotted crotchets. and take it at about 120. Even maybe a little slower, about 112, because we've got to work out the bar before two. And here again, you need the lightest of touches. The way I would do this is have a really, really good set of muscles. I like to compare it to a bagpipe, you know, that you are the bag. You are the bag. And I don't think the staccato needs to be all that short. I mean, you can, as long as the attack isn't too aggressive. And take that nice and slow. Just take that maybe at 104. And then you've got the fives. Which at this speed are very manageable. And make a distinction between the five and the trill. And I'm going to leave it at the meno allegro and now hop over to the finale. So this is where the virtue of slow practice comes in for these really nasty triplets around the throat tones. You take it at the absolute slowest speed to learn all these notes. And then the next bit's a little bit quicker, we'll come to that. But we'll go back now to just after 24. I'm going to whack it up to about 112 now. And then etc. And then we come back to the finale. Mm-hmm. and then let's go back down to 24. Here it is, trills. So that's, let me speed it up now to 120. Tangential sort of things I need, like I like to do when I'm looking at a piece. So we're finished with the first page. So let's have a look at the second. And I think as we were working on those chromatic diminished sevenths, we should jump down to just after six, where again we're faced with these. But what I would do is I would practice them in time, because even if I'm playing a really, really fast run, I try to at least pulse it a little bit, because it sounds more effective and you lose less notes if you do that. So for here, so that's actually, I'll take it even slower. How about that? I'll take it to 72 and I'll show you what I mean. So that you creep it up to 80. Actually, and if you have sort of some sort of musical notation with a click track, you could actually pretty much build your own accelerando. So at about 88. etc. I don't know how to do it with this metronome, but you could have someone sort of pressing the button, helping you to get a bit faster. Yes, I like this little the poco lento, melancholia, melancholy. You can play a little with the tempo here. The music seems to encourage it, especially on those runs up and down with the tenuto on the first note. A little bit. So you need to get a nice D. I would prepare for it and have the bagpipe of air already there. And you can even have a breath attack. Just be comfortable with it for whatever you do. Don't squeeze. and a real sweetness to the throat tones, and then getting to the lower shalamo part of the instruments, a real richness. Really sigh those. Try and make the octave sound like the one octave. So senza rigor, without sort of the without sort of a definite beat, sort of play around with a bit. And a real sigh there. Really rich. These throat tones can sound sharp, stick a few fingers down. So that's a really, really nice bit, and it doesn't come back, but really pretty part of the piece. Okay, so I'm going to take a break and come back with the next parts of the piece. So thanks for listening, and I look forward to part two.